shareholding. I think there are two schools of thought, simple as this. There's a keep 100% school of thought, come what may, and the other one is, it's better to have a, whatever it is, small piece of a big pie. That first line of thought is put forward by a chap called Felix Dennis. Oh, good. And can I just take an aside here and say, you really don't need to go to the MBA program here to learn how to be an entrepreneurship. So save yourself 50K. Two books you need to know, spend 20 pounds, £10 on that book, How to Get Rich. Yeah, offensive title, but it's a thorny, you know, it's a red in tooth and claw subject, this one. Great book. I would thoroughly recommend that to everyone, How to Get Rich by Felix Dennis. And the old classic, this great old well-known one, Mark McCormack's What They Don't Teach You at Harvard Business School. And they don't teach you at Cranfield either, actually, so come to that. So I recommend those two. So Felix Dennis would say, keep 100% come what may. I don't. I'm very much put my feet very firmly in the second camp. Don't give it away, but make sure that you share it around. I've got three kids. I don't know quite how I had the time, but I have. When I do go home, I do find I have three children. And they were each given by Sarah's father, my parents are dead, for a sum of 50 quid each, some shares, in January, which then we declared a dividend on, their C shares, a dividend of £2,000 a share. Handy for a £50 share. The reason it's good is, of course, because children do not pay, have a capital gains allowance, just as we do, up to £6,000 or something. So, of course, that dividend goes to them, into their little baby trusty bank accounts or whatever it is. There's no tax come into the Clarke household for all of this money that's gone to the children, and then they can pay things like their own school fees out of it. So very clever. If you've got the ability to issue C shares on your company and you happen to have children and you want to spend some money, holidays or whatever, then for goodness sake, jump on that one. It's just tremendous. The clause I'd love to have, and Joanna, if you want to have this one, I'm up for it, is called the Mexican standoff clause. It's a great one. And the idea is you can't agree on something. Majority and minority cannot get on. So what you do is you send a letter to your lawyers with just a figure in it. And I say, I think the company's worth 8 million quid. And Joanna says, oh, I think it's worth 9. Lawyer opens the thing and says, Joanna, 9 million quid. You win. So Joanna has to buy all my shares off me for the valuation of the 9 million quid. And I'm free. I walk away. She's got the company. She cared that much to bid it and so forth and the other way. And equally, I could eliminate her because she hasn't stumped up enough money or hasn't got the means to raise the money, and I get rid of her. I suppose it's getting probably personal. it's a great clause because I think it's fair, and it does give minority shareholders the right to challenge a majority shareholder. I never think that's actually a bad thing, personally, but opinions differ. Remember to be respectful of other people and their needs and why they're doing what they're doing. It's a pleasure. If you've got shareholding, then dish it out. But make sure you give it to people who you respect and equally who respect you, because don't be a mug. Don't just give it to people who you think are rather clever. Make certain that they have respect for you, because they will look after you as you look after them. This is absolutely critical. When I sit down, and when I have ever sat down with my fellow directors, it is on a one-to-one basis. I have a vote as to what I think we may do, and the other individual has a vote as to what they think they're going to do. And if we happen to disagree, then whoever is right carries the day. And it's as simple as that. Shareholding, in my view, has got absolutely nothing to do with the operational running of the business. And finally, this point again, is that lawyers are there, just there to help out. I require our lawyer to come along and talk to Joanna and me in the same room simultaneously. What he tries to do is phone me up very quietly and says, Harry, old boy, I don't think we really ought to talk about this one, you know, Joanna's presence and da-da-da-da-da. No, Andrew, that's not the case. If there's something to be said, it has to be said in front of us, because it does. It will insidiously, invidiously drive a wedge between you. Don't let them try and suggest clever little clauses that happen to suit you, because it will only backfire, in my view. That is my thoughts on shareholding. Thank you.
Partner with people you trust. I think trust and understand, very, very important. Because I'd spent 20 years with Trevor, or known him for 20 years, he was the right guy to do it. Also partner with people who have complementary skills and personality. If you're both very, very strong-headed people, you know, I would suggest that you will have a few difficulties along the way. It may still work, but I think the reason why Trevor and I are still together 12 years on is because we do have a complementary personalities. be flattered by it. You know, you run a business, you start a business, it gets going, somebody comes along and says, great business, guys, we'd like to buy it. Okay, you know, but don't get taken. It's not necessarily the best deal in town. And then finally, I think the point that Harry was making as well, you know, there has to be trust. You know, you're never going to get agreement. You're never going to sign up to agreement if you want to dot every I and cross every T and be completely covered, because it won't happen. You know, you have to take a risk, and there has to be trust. You have to trust the people you're working with and the people you're partnering with as well. So, thank you.
At law, you do have different responsibilities. Employees have what we call duty of good faith. You know, don't go spilling the beans on your company, but limited, as you will probably know from experience. Directors have a whole range of responsibilities, and it behoves you to be very careful, actually, when you take, if you're a non-exec, where you do take directorships. And as shareholders, you actually have very limited obligations, very, very limited obligations. And again, that often comes as a surprise to people. Have you all got the same commitment of time and energy? Have you all got the same specialist knowledge? Or has somebody got more specialist knowledge? Capital contribution versus business building skills, really important. You know, we have to kiss a lot of frogs, you know, when you're building businesses. And sometimes you do have to take people in, don't you, who don't have your entrepreneurial skills. And you have to be either make a... Look, just be conscious about it. That's what I say to people. It is what it is. It's a perfectly valid decision to give someone more shareholding than you think they're actually worth. But just do it consciously. No competition. What outside interests of your fellow shareholders have got? What do they aspire to have? One very important thing I just want to mention here, different ages. It shouldn't matter, should it? It does matter. If you're I don't know, 38, looking forward to 20-odd years in this business, and you bring you're in business with maybe the existing owner of that business, the originator, who's 55 looking to retire, you're going to have very, 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 very different expectations on exit. If you are employed in the business and a shareholder, if you leave for whatever reason as an employee, of course your shares are still there, because they're not connected unless we make them connected. And what will happen in what good leaver, bad leaver means, it's shorthand to mean, in the employment contract, you'll find provisions that say, if you're a good leaver, yeah, we're still going to buy your shares back, guys, but we're going to pay market value or something akin to market value for them. If you're a bad leaver, well, Harry said they'd pay nothing. Latest case law suggests we probably can't pay nothing. But usually you'd pay the lower of par value and market value, because market value might be less. Maybe because that's why he's leaving. You never know.